which means we're still going strong after an hour. We're going to talk about Impact. No Lucha Look Back this week. I forgot to mention at the top of the show, but I just realized that this show goes up on Mondays or Tuesday mornings, depending on time frames. So technically, this would be the first show. So, that makes sense. I had some issues trying to get Tubi to work, and I didn't realize that it was my new ad blocker keeping it from happening. So, yep, what are you going to do? Marcus, general thoughts on this week's edition of Impact before we get into it?
It was cool. Entertaining the show. Obviously, they were revving up for Resurgence.
Emergence. No, I'm serious. Emergence. Resurgence is the New Japan show.
We're both right because everybody's, you know, working together.
Yes, now. Technically you are because Moose was on the show and they were building up the Jay White Finley feud almost predominantly on Impact.
Yeah. Yeah. So
So this was the Jinx week.
Exactly. And we had some, we had some returns and we had some exits and just some overall good stuff. So yeah, it was a solid show, entertaining. More so, a setup show, but an entertaining setup show.
Now, if I remember correctly, we started the show with Taylor Wilde versus Tennille Dashwood, correct?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So we haven't seen Tennille in a few months. The whole thing was injuries or what have you, and who took me out? But I think it may have been more specifically like I'm sure she probably had to actually do her job because she is a firefighter up in Canada. So I'm sure there's a lot of snow fires, I guess, because it's Canada. it was a fine match, but I wasn't too excited because she lost. And I really don't know why they're booking her to not win so much. If I remember correctly, Caleb with a K got involved. No, Madison, that's right. It's all coming back to me like a bad song from the 90s. Madison Rayne came out of retirement and costed Taylor Wilde the win. I thought we were done with Madison Rayne, but just when we think we're out, she pulls us back in, I think. I think that's how it goes.
The female Leo Rush of Impact.
Power on Jitsu's like, no, he's just doing his last dates. No, he's doing right by the companies. And I'm like sitting there like, I love that you think that's true. Marcus, do you want to see more Madison Rayne?
She's entertaining, but this is a bit of old hat. I really like Madison Rayne, but and I get it between her and Tennille because they had a little thing going on obviously with the talk show and whatnot. I actually did like her talk show. I thought it was the more entertaining version of what Tennille's trying to do. But yeah, it's kind of this old hat. It's like how many times have we seen, Impact is kind of like her safety net in a lot of ways. Mm-hmm. And it's good because she's always loyal, but, it's only so many times, we can come back to the same old thing. So it'll be interesting seeing what she do because at this point, poor Kimber doesn't have any...
Kimber don't have no soul.
I'm getting... Not Kimber. Taylor Rod don't really have any backup right now. So.
Oh, yeah. Nope, that's true. Next up, we got Josh Alexander versus Sean Daivari. Apparently, Sean Daivari is doing the work because he's definitely... Because the rumor was that he was working as a producer for the WB, but maybe that was more of a tryout situation. But I've been seeing him pop up everywhere now. MLW, I saw him in Impact. And I'm pretty sure... Where else did I just see him? I just saw him somewhere else. So it looks like he's, going to be sticking around. And I like that. I like Sean Daivari. I think he's actually he's not a athletic hand by any means, but he's a good hand. And if they bring in his brother Aria, I think that would be a really interesting tag team, especially if they do that gimmick that they were doing or that Sean was doing in Lucha Underground, where he was that kind of that Lothario, that all gold kind of standard guy that they were doing. I think it was a season 3 or 4. Remember that? Came out in like all gold, in like whites, in like season 3 or 4 of Lucha Underground.
Yeah.
I think that'd be an interesting tag team, if that's the idea they go with. Alexander gets the one over Daivari, obviously, because Alexander's not going to lose until, I don't know, ever. but the match was more of a spotlight because Jake something was watching it and then confronted Josh Alexander in the ring. Things got a little tense. They're going to meet at Emergence. God damn it. Now I'm asking myself, was that the right one? I'm pretty sure it was Emergence. But it could have been Resurgence. Damn you. You gave him the easy ones. I'm looking forward to the Jake Something and Josh Alexander match. I don't even care if they build it up or not. I think that match will just be interesting because they're just two very different styles, but two very interesting prospects. So I'm looking forward to it. Any thoughts on that one, Marcus?
No. Right, no, cool. I'm saying that with you, man. It's been cool to see Jake's rise. Like I said, they could have just went one way with, you know, that fallout between him and Dina, but they really made a concerted effort to kind of keep both of them elevated and obviously feuding with each other immediately and then kind of going off from there. So, you know, Dina's had his wins and now something has had his and building up towards. Obviously, Dina has gotten going with the tag shots and now potentially something gets a shot at Alexander. I can't see him knocking him off, but I think he'll be a hell of a contender for it. Like, you know, Tarus was one thing, and I think something will be another because there's not too many people that can, you know, just going to match Alexander in pure power and may overmatch him in that regard. So it's going to be interesting seeing that contrast of, you know, the power and the technique of Alexander with the just sheer raw muscle and ambition with something. So, like you said, even if they don't build it up, it'll be something to watch.
I like Jay something, but he's got to get better last name. So then we get Tasha Steelz. I'm reading the recap on Impact, and it says, after Tasha Steelz betrayed her last week, Kiera Hogan is in the ring. She wants to talk about what happened with Steelz, but that doesn't end up happening because Sue Young comes out with the Undead Brides, Kimberly in tow, dressed all to her nines, and she gets in poor Kiera's cute little face and mandible claws her into the oblivion. So, yeah, they killed off another wrestler via Sue Young. Thoughts?
No, man. I'm trying to see what's... oh, yeah, that was freaking Civil War when old dude blew up in front of Cap. He was like, when you got to go, you got to go. And that's kind of where Kira's at right now. So I did what she's doing on her way out because you could just be a situation where she just leaves without any explanation. But also she had to fall out with Tasha and now she's doing with this. And look, the great thing about those storylines with Sue Young and Rosemary, they are very convenient plot devices to get somebody to freak off screen and make it believable because, you know, they basically got dragged to the undead realm or whatever, you know, so.
Yeah. The cool thing about Kiera Hogan leaving, granted, you know, she's probably going to go to AEW. She's already doing some work there. But the cool thing about her leaving is she's already put over Tasha Steelz's new partner, and now she's put over Kimberly. So, like, she's doing the right thing on the way out, and I appreciate that. Like, I really do. I'm going to miss her. But she's doing it the right way.
Yeah.
We get some promos with Don Callis, but the next match is Jay White versus Chris Bay. And I'm sorry, not Jay White versus. Is Bullet Club Jay White and Chris Bay? Sorry, the Bullet Club versus Finjuice. Favorite match of the night. These dudes do great work. I love me some Juice Robinson. I think they're really elevating Chris Bay with this Bullet Club idea, and it's giving him this almost this dogged soldier of approval idea. Like he has to prove that he's worthy of the Bullet Club brand. And I think that's like an interesting way to go. There's definitely like a lot of effort and desire to be a part of this group. So I want to see more of that, and I hope it grows in impact. I've already mentioned that before. I think it would be great to have a Bullet Club US brand. And they even talked about it a little bit on Emergence, Resurgence. Damn it, I'm doing it. Unironically, I'm doing it. Where they talked about how the NWO built the NWO Japan and how Bullet Club is building up the Bullet Club in USA. So I would like to see more Bullet Club members, please. The match itself was great. Go check it out. Maybe great's a little overstating it, but it's good. I would say it's one of the reasons to watch this week. Definitely. Marcus, any thoughts on this one?
No, man, same here. You know, getting to see that combination, man. And also, like I said, this is building up between White and Finn, which, you know, go check out that match if you get the opportunity. So it's some good stuff. But yeah, I'm digging this relationship between Bay and White. Beyblade, hashtag Beyblade. Don't know how long it's gonna last, but I hope they keep it up. And if nothing else, me and Chad got, like Chad said, that was like the best picture with Tanahashi, that Coliseum picture. For me, like the best wrestling video was the the skating video with the variants of Jay White and Chris Bay. So that's two top wrestling things this year that are actually wrestling related. So I appreciate it.
The only thing that tops it has been the last two or three episodes of My Hero Academia, and Bakugo and his just sheer unbridled anger has come fully unleashed.
What was that you said, number one? You said, just catch a villain faster than me just once. Just this one, Winter, just this once. They're like, no, you did it. You were great. God damn it, you could be a bit more pissed off about it.
My favorite part was how he's so uncomfortable with the family drama. And he just starts yelling at him. You know, it's not very polite to have family drama when you have guests over.
He was like, did you know about the drama about to go? It's kind of hard. I was ear hustling during the festival. What?
I overheard you two talking because you're so loud. So we get Deonna Purrazzo talking about her recent training with Invicta FC Atomweight champion Alicia Zapatella. Zapadella? She's Italian. I can't pronounce her name because I'm just terrible with words. Mushmouth. Melina reveals that she'll be making her Impact debut next week ahead of her match with Purrazzo at Empower. We then get an conversation that we saw on AEW. It's Christian Cage talking to the one guy that didn't work on Impact, Alex Marvez. He's actually much better as a backstage interviewer. When he's not forced to kind of think of things on the fly to say about wrestling matches, I think he's a lot more cogent. And he did a great little interview. I love that they have lockers. That's what I'm missing from the Impact aesthetic. Is remember that how they had that set that you knew was clearly a set, like almost like a porn set, where it's like 12 lockers and like they're 6x6, and you're like, this is clearly not a locker room. It's clearly just a room that you put lockers in. I miss that set.
Yeah,
I
remember when I was, and yeah, you probably remember this when Jeff Hardy was going around doing his apology tour.
Yep. I mostly remember the main event Mafia and Christian Cage. Actually, ironically enough, do you remember it was a pay per view in 2008? I want to say it was Against All Odds in February or March, and it was Christian, Tom Cohen, Styles, and they were talking about how Christian was going to win the belt back. And then Great Muda walks in with an interpreter. And Christian freaks out because Muda's like dressed to the nines in his Muda gear. That's what I remember most of the fake locker rooms. That and Scott Steiner getting mad at Booker T and Kurt Angle in the main event Mafia locker room. I'll miss those dumbass.
No, you're not wrong. Remember, the Muda thing escapes me because I got to go back and watch that. But definitely the main. And also, that kind of had to be that way for the main event Mafia, because you can't say you're, you know, this type of faction, with all these legends and high rollers, if you will, and be in, like, Goldberg's broom closet.
Exactly.
You know what I'm saying? So, you know, so.
Goldberg's broom closet. I just saw Goldberg's son for the first time, because, like, apparently he was doing stuff with his dad. And, like, the funniest thing was, like, I saw him, I'm like, wait, is that the same little pudgy kid from before?
Yeah, it is. And I thought you had saw it. That's why I never sent it to you.
Wait, is this the video of Goldberg's son when he was like 12 spearing some baseball mascot? I saw that.
No, because they did this. He was on Raw and they did this legend with MVP. And he was in the office. I'm like, wait a minute. That ain't his freaking son. What happened to that little punchy? And people were like, puberty hit him hard, Margo.
Margo, he all glowed up.
as the kids will say, he lit. But no, man. Yeah, that's him. Yeah, I went and did a side by side. I'm like, no, he just, that's, he had a hell of a growth spurt. He when he was chubby and kind of clumsy like, and now he, you know,
he looks sure like an athlete.
Yeah, pretty sure he's getting some numbers now. So, you know, kudos to Goldberg and whatnot, and little Goldberg. So,
Baby Berg. Next match, Matt Cardona takes on John Skyler. Skyler gets the upset victory, thanks to Rohit, that dastardly Rohit. And now John Skyler is my favorite thing in the world, because Matt Cardona makes me want to do terrible, terrible things to people.
Don't hear no complaints from me.
Right. Let's see. Then the main events. It was the Contenders Battle Royal for the world title shot at Emergence. The participants are Sammy Callahan, Moose, Petey Williams, Sam Beal, Brian Myers, Willie Mack, Rhino, Diener, Rich Swan, Falaba, Ace Austin, Suicide, W. Morrissey, No Way, as in No Way Jose, Madman Fulton, Eddie Edwards, Johnny Swinger, Hernandez, Chris Sabin, and Trey Miguel. And the winner, because this is before the debut of Rampage, the winner will take on Kenny Omega or Christian Cage for the world title on August 20th at Emergence. The winner is Brian Myers. And if I remember correctly, he kind of wins kind of dumb. Sabin and Moose were the last real two contenders standing, and Myers is the one who eliminates them both. I don't think that this was the right call or a good call or a call that I would have cared about. You had Sabin right there. And now, granted, they're putting Sabin in a lot of contendership matches and like some like championship ideas, so there might be an idea of putting Sabin in a world title match eventually.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like they went on ahead and did this because continuing to tell this story, because the whole thing between him and Moose is that it's not over, which was the best part of this last match because they still going back and forth. They probably would have been able to pay attention to Miles had they not been so focused on each other. And I feel like if you would have went with one of them, it would have been inherently for them to be like, well, obviously such and such is going to interfere, right? And again, not like we could use more interference in world title matches. So, I get it there. Maybe they could do a triple threat with them once their individual feud is over, perhaps, or something like that. But, like I said, Myers, not to knock the guy, but he feels like a coming-in warm-up for Christian. And because if they drop it to Miles, I'm gone. Like, I'm not even. It's not even.
I'll tell you what. If Myers wins the world title from Christian, whatever life raft you're on, I'm jumping on myself. We'll sail away until we find 0-1, or we'll hook up with I don't know, PWG. No, I don't want to do that. We'll start watching ECW, like Eastern Championship Wrestling.
There it is. Me and Chad are gonna start an American extension of Rinka King.
Just have Scott Steiner terrorizing the audience. That's the bit.
Exactly.
That's the joke.
They mentioned, as soon as that bell rang, like, Brian, nope. Then DeMore's going to come up. But we found the curly haired girl from the old Impact tapers. No. You are not doing that to us. No. But give one of us a number. But no, we're not coming back. Give one of us a number, but we're not coming back to you for that. Okay, like it would be the stupidest decision, and then because that'll be a way where y'all said y'all wanted on the Impact guy, like, whatever, man.
And we didn't mean that Impact guy. We didn't mean that Impact guy. The
wrong type of Impact. But yeah, so that's gonna be a thing. And like I said, maybe the match turns out to be better than it should be. We ultimately won't care because, you know, there's bigger stuff to be, I think, to be done. Like you said, Impact built, TNA built him, Impact will carry him. And to me, you know, going off your idea, it almost makes logical sense to run him into Alexander. Not to immediately knock something, but Alexander's on too much of a roll right now. You know, unless he gets, you know, severely interfered with and something just turns into a cheating curmudgeon heel. You know, I think you got to run those guys into each other. So
hopefully Brian Myers doesn't win. That's all I got to say about that. All right, Marcus, any final thoughts on making an Impact before you head off for the night?
No, that's it for me.
All right, then. For Marcus Green, which you can find on Twitter at ParadoxKid, P-A-R-A-D-O-X-K-I-D.
Where I be.
Also on the True Penny Show. Check out True Penny Show on Twitter, TruePennyShow. I'm Chad Porter. You can find me on Twitter at Chad Nerdcorp, CHADNERDCORPN on Instagram at Chad's Photo Hut. This has been the Making Impact podcast brought to you by RealNerdCorp.com, RealNerdCorp.com, which you can find us on Twitter.